Good evening. We're going to call to order the Thursday, June the 8th, 2017 meeting of the Planning Board. To begin every meeting, we have a public comment section. This is if you'd like to make a public comment on anything that is not on the agenda for tonight. Going once, going twice, okay. Then we'll call the first item for 7 p.m. Special permit for 10-lot open space residential cluster development and site plan for shared driveways with associated site development by the Office of Planning and Sustainability on Burt's Pit Road, Florence Map ID 29012/10. And I think Wayne is going to do a presentation.
Thank you. Wayne Biden, Planning Sustainability. So this piece of property, which Doug Cole alive for a number of years at the time of this March development, what you see in red here is about 125 acres of land that's there. And that's the property we're talking about. That's the property we're talking about today. So it has frontage on a lot of roads. It's main frontage on Burt's Pit Road, Stone Ridge Drive, Sandy Hill, and Overlook, and has a tiny finger of land onto Florence Road. So it sort of comes around, and this is basically all the undeveloped area that's left in this neighborhood. So we're almost completely developed on all sides. When Doug was alive, this was the plan that he had planned to do, sort of a lot of large premium lots, spreading out throughout the entire area. The neighborhood was very concerned, and a lot of environmental work went into the process. And so Doug's initial plan probably was oversold a little bit. This is sort of, when we did this a year ago, when we first got this property under auction, this was our assessment, what could happen. There's some vernal pools at the end of Stone Ridge Drive, and so that area almost definitely couldn't be developed. There is a rare turtle on the property. And so there's rare turtle habitat, which is why the other three axes are there. But Natural Heritage has released their draft map. Every few years they do their maps of estuarine habitat. They've reduced their draft maps, which if it doesn't change, goes in effect the end of this year. And they are delisting this turtle from their list. So this is showing four areas that couldn't be developed, but probably two of them actually could come back on the list if Natural Heritage dropped it. So the reason I say this is, this plan that Doug did is realistic, but I don't want to use it to scare people, because I think this is sort of might be more what it would be done. And the market has changed, so if somebody was doing this, they would absolutely do development from Burt's Pit Road, from Overlook, from Sandy Hill Road. They wouldn't necessarily run a road the entire distance, right? And roads are $600 a foot, it might be hard to get. So it wouldn't be as dramatic, but there'd certainly be a lot of lots that's out there. And this is basically the scenario that we're trying to do. So I'm not very good at colors. The light green, I guess it is, the brighter green snaps, that's conservation land that we already have. Marsh, bog conservation area. The darker green, the more natural green on this, that's all the land we want to permanently protect. So we'd be adding about 121 acres of land would be added to our open space. 117 from the land we're buying from Defina Associates, Doug Cole's old company, and 4 acres we'll be buying from the Butter. So that land would be permanently protected. And then development would be clustered in two areas. On the north, on Stone Ridge Drive, there'd be two lots. We're not involved with that. So the developer's just keeping that land, so that's not what's before you. He got permits from this board 30 years ago, and those permits are still in effect, so he has the right to do that. So that's really not what's before you. What we're looking at is that bottom left, the 10 acres that are there. I just want to make sure you understand the context, because all my other views would be zooming in 10 acres, where of course there's a lot of development, but the context is sort of preserving the rest of this property. So you have all these plans that what I passed out today is a set that's revised basically addressed to the stormwater comments. The basic view of what was in the packet a month ago hasn't changed, but just some details have changed. So this again is just the zoom in of what was more attractive in the last color version, but just for context, that big parcel of land is going to be permanently protected open space. So I'm not spending time in these, but that's sort of so you know what it is in your plans. This is the land to the north. Again, we're not very involved with this. These are the two lots off Stone Ridge Drive. We did work with the developer here have separately, and it was required before you tonight, just to move some of the boundaries. So Those two lots would have taken up all the access on Stone Ridge Drive. We did want to buy a 50-foot sliver of land to get to Stone Ridge Drive. So there's some rejigger of property boundaries so that he still has the same two lots he has now, and we get this 50-foot swath. We actually own the land to the north, so we have public access in, but it's steep and sandy, and this is sort of a flatter site, the existing logging roads. And then this is where we're going to spend most of the rest of the time on. This is the 10 lots we're looking at. So, in doing this, I think aligned with both Sustainable Northampton and with your criteria. The first, we're trying to minimize the footprint of the project. Obviously, we're doing that by squeezing everything to 3 acres of land and preserving 121 acres. But also in terms of the layout, so we're double stacking the homes. So there's 10 lots, but there's only 5 frontages. And that's so we can keep that look and feel. You know, Burstcourt Road is sort of partially suburban road. Sometimes it sort of feels rural. And so we're trying to keep that rural nature. So you drive along Burstcourt Road, and as you come into this property, there'll be a long distance where it feels very natural. There'll all be a conservation area. And then suddenly you see 5 lots in a row that make it feel the area. That was a very deliberate part. Likewise, we want to minimize the driveways. So 10 lots with a total of 4 driveways. That's the least number of driveways we could do that comply with the regulations. And the way we're dividing this up is there's different developers who are buying. This is the role of a master developer. We're putting it in this project, but we're obviously not in the development business. So we'll be selling these in a series of pieces. The 2 lots on this view that are on your left are being retained by the developer. We have to get the permits for them as part of this process, but they're being retained. The other lots we're going to be selling, some for market rate and some for affordable housing, which I'll talk about more. Again, narrowing the footprint of that. So, and that minimum driveway is important both from a stormwater standpoint and from a stormwater standpoint. We had a neighborhood meeting that my office sponsored and Councilor LaBarge sponsored 4 months ago, exactly when. And we notified everybody sort of in this area. We had maybe 30 or 40 people show up. A lot of concern from the neighborhood. Most of the people, once they realized how much land we were preserving, went away. They didn't mind that. The immediate abutters on Burstcourt Road, frankly, were still very concerned with the people who faced this. And what we heard was 3 major concerns. One was they wanted to look like their homes in terms of setbacks. So what we did is, so we're trying to, frankly, they didn't want any homes. I'm not trying to, in terms of where we're trying to mitigate those things. They wanted setbacks that match their homes. The zoning would allow front setback of 30 feet. We're putting our own rule on, which you're welcome to reflect in the permit, of 41 feet. So we're moving 11 feet further than the zoning requires. When we actually laid out the homes, some would be 41 feet from the front property boundary, some would be 59 feet from the front property boundary. And because this is an area without sidewalks, there's a lot of public right-of-way, so when you actually measure from what people see, so we don't have a setback from road pavement, but when you actually looked at that, we'd have 52 to 67 feet. So what's in the right column is when we looked at the homes across the street. So we didn't look at the entire neighborhood, we looked at all the homes that are directly across the street, and we're more or less in the range. Our closest home will be 5 feet closer, but some of our homes will be further away. So it seemed like we fit that scenario there. And the other thing you see more in this slide again is they were concerned about how many trees we'd have to cut down. And it's no question we have to cut down trees, we have to regrade part of the site, but we're doing tree replacement. And what you see a little bit in this air photo, it may not be really obvious, is in our tree planting, basically trying to match the pattern that they have. None of those homes are in dense forests. All of them are mature street trees. You drive along, and it looks really nice, but then they have big front yards. So again, ours will look like theirs, although, to be honest, when we plant a 2.5-inch caliper tree, it's going to be a lot smaller than a tree that's been there for 20 years. And then the stormwater is actually our biggest challenge. But we're trying to meet, and the reason is because it's not a lot of street drainage descended to. So the normal standard for DPW and for you is no increase in peak flow. Berkshire Design is basically trying to do no increase in any flow. so the total amount of water they're going to site isn't greater. The way they're doing that is a series of small rain gardens and drainage areas to catch the water. And of course, from a water quality standpoint, if water picks up speed, it carries a lot of sediment. So we're trying to catch the water as soon as it runs off and put it back into the ground. Our biggest challenge, frankly, was these are going to be 10 single-family homes. It's not a subdivision. It's not going to be a homeowner association. And large retention ponds, which you all see often, can work really well when they have somebody who maintains them. It's not going to work in someone's backyard. So we wanted subtle landscape features that are going to fit in as much as possible in the landscape that people have to maintain, obviously not fill them. So that's sort of what you see here. DPW issued our stormwater permit today, so we see their criteria. And then, so again, open space, from a grand scheme of things, we're preserving 121 acres. From the zoning standpoint, open space, what we can each lot, the area with this hash mark, that's the area we won't be cutting trees. So we're trying to preserve as much trees and forest as possible on the property, but there's an area we have to re-cut. So you see some lots, the middle two lots in front, have a lot of regrading. So we're cutting down all the trees, and some lots have a lot of preserved area. But, so to the extent we could, we're trying to preserve all of that that's there. I'm sure at this scale you can't see this, but again, we asked Berkshire to do, design to do is think about rain gardens that don't require a lot of maintenance. So you know, if you look at the rain gardens we have, the senior center, or the rain gardens that called Morganville, those are great rain gardens, but you have to maintain them. These, we know homeowners don't do that kind of thing. So that was sort of the standard for this piece. And then you all know, this is, you've been planning board for more than a year, you adopted, you got city council, fairly strict standards recently about replacement of large trees. And so we have, in order for this project to happen, we do have to cut down a significant number of trees. We replanted on site the extent we could, but if you're cutting down a 10-inch tree, that's a lot of trees, and we basically couldn't replant this. This isn't like a budget, there's just not enough room to squeeze, you know, you can't put two trees 5 feet from each other. So what we're proposing is all the trees that we couldn't fit on, so we're keeping track, and it's in the application exactly how much caliper inches we owe. We're proposing to plant those in conservation areas where we have a lot of disturbed sites which we want to restore. So they won't be areas we wouldn't be doing trees otherwise. So for example, Elwell Island, it was farmed once a long, long time ago, and the sod is so thick that it's been really hard to plant trees. Nature Conservancy planted a few elm trees for us for a study to see if we can get reestablish elms, and it was a huge amount of work. But we might plant some trees there. We have some land. We have a lot of places where we have invasive trees. So if you're on the bike path in Leeds, off Grove, you go in and the area is half invasives. And we cut them down recently as part of the bike path. We'd like to plant new mature, not mature trees, but new trees that will shade that out. So then we can treat the understory and get new trees planted. So we have a lot of those. Chesterfield Road, we have a conservation area which was farmland. It hasn't been for 20 years, but it's grown up. We're closing actually next couple of weeks in a piece of land right off of Lindsay Road. It's in Northampton, but it abuts Lindsay Road and Hatfield. And it has about 10 acres of farmland and about 5 acres that's been allowed to grow up because it's too difficult to farm. And it is almost 100% invasives. So we have a lot of places, including the conservation area right nearby, where we plant those trees. So we would certainly keep track of them. We're required to show that those trees are thriving, replace them if they don't thrive, and that would certainly be an ongoing condition, of course, that would make sure that happens. And then this is sort of the view, this is just from Google Street View. But this is what I was saying about, there's some wonderful, these are the homes directly across the street from our site. And so you can see, again, there's some wonderful street trees, but these homes are not in the woods themselves. They're, you know, wonderful large lawns with street trees. And that's sort of the look we're trying to get. Save trees when we can, replant them when we can't. The other thing which was most controversial in the neighborhood, which we didn't want to compromise on, is we are planning to do 3 affordable housing loans. So the property, again, is going to be 10 units, 2 the developer's keeping. He gets to choose how he does them. 8 we get. 1 we're swapping for some more land. So I said we got 117 acres of open space from Doug Cole, 4 acres from somebody else. That 4 acres is a place we, right, it abuts this area, we didn't think was appropriate for a home. So we're taking his land and giving that person one of these building lots. Four of these lots we're selling for market rate prices, whatever we get. And three, we're gonna look for an affordable housing developer. So our goal is to get homes priced at worst at 100% of area median income, and ideally at 80% or 60% of area median income. And our plan, some of you probably came to our small streets design, small lots design competition we did about 3 years ago. This will be similar. We're going to do what's called Green Housing for All. So it's a design competition. We're looking for architects to enter. There's going to be a class at UMass who's doing an entire studio on this to show how can we get workforce housing available at 100% of median income or below at sort of a Habitat for Humanity work program. So 1,100 square feet or less, no basements, no garages. So making them more affordable just by being smaller. Trying to be either zero energy, net zero energy, or actually energy positive, if you want to get to a solar panel, so make the homes as efficient as possible, and then PV on the roof. And to the extent we can get new ideas about lowering the construction, doing that. So that's core to us, and we don't want to drop that. City Council is very excited about that. But I just show pictures here because we've done other projects like this with partners, sometimes with the city leading. We did one on Ryan Road. Sometimes other people have led. Community Builders did this on Rocky Hill Road. And I use these pictures for neighborhoods to sort of challenge them to say, I don't think if you go down Ice Pond Drive, you can tell the difference between the affordable units and the non-affordable units. If you look up, if you went inside, you would. There's not granite counters in the affordable units that are the non-affordable units. But so that's sort of what we're trying to do, is homes that fit in the scenario. And then finally, you all know that it's for site plan approval, there's a traffic mitigation section. And there's sort of two ways, we think we're doing three things that for the traffic mitigation. The first, of course, is typically we could figure out the number of homes we could do by right, approval not required lots, and don't have to do traffic mitigation for those because we could do that. You can see how much frontage we're not using along Birchfield Road, so we could certainly do more homes. The second is obviously having the shared driveways. The biggest traffic challenge is the intersection, so we're sharing. But the final one, this is one of the key ones for us, is you all know in the last 4 or 5 years, we've built about 11 miles of rail trails, and that now serves about 65% of the city's population. But we built them, frankly, because that's where the railroads happen to be. We have a long-term plan to feed the western part of the city. We'll be going off of Route 10, where the Route 10 bike path bridge is. We bought some land between Route 10 and Route 66, which we're currently designing a path. We already have a path that goes from Route 66 up to Florence Road. We have a right-of-way most of the way up to Birchfield Road. This will be the key next section. So the red line on here is land available for a multi-use trail. We don't have money to build that now. This is just putting the land aside. But this is about a half-mile trail. It would connect from the Emerson Way. The trail that comes through Emerson Way. It would go out to Overlook Drive, where from there it's a quiet neighborhood street, so one could go to the Ryan Road School easily. It would go up to Sandy Hill Road, where one could go in the neighborhood, and not part of this phase, but the hope is eventually go up to Clark Street and up to the brand new bike path we put at Florence Recreation Fields. So the idea is sort of the rail trails now are sort of the main network, and we build a big loop connecting between the rail trails goes to the south and the rail trail goes to the north, and then we're done. But so this is a key part of the process. And I think that's it. Yeah.
Thank you. Questions from the board before we open public comment? Mark?
You said we got the stormwater permit from the DPW. Do they have any comments or any qualifications?
The only qualification is the essence of reopen. Our engineer said we think it's 2 feet of groundwater for the rain gardens. DPW said when you build the things, if it's not 2 feet of groundwater, you're going to have to, spread them out, make them shallower and bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a few ongoing conditions like that. But no, nothing behind the maintenance issues. The one change we're asking them to make, which they may or may not make, but just so you know, is you have to do annual reports for most of these stormwater permits. They're asking to be done by a professional engineer. That's hard for single-family home lots. That makes sense for a bigger project. So we're asking them to be homeowner certification, which they've done elsewhere. But again, whatever they make us do,
there were other comments from the engineering side of DPW. I forwarded those to a few few minutes ago.
Okay.
You haven't seen them, so I can go over those either now or after you do public comment, whatever you wanna do.
Just a question on the, back to the beginning with the, so each of these lots is gonna have a small retention apparatus?
It varies from lot to lot, so the two lots, we're calling lots one and two, which are furthest to the west, have the least amount, just because it didn't do as much good in that area. But yes, everybody has something, some more than others.
They're rain gardens though, so they're not gonna be like mini detention ponds on each parcel, they're gonna act differently.
And they're not connected to any?
Not by pipe, they're connected by overflow.
By overflow, but they're not, yeah.
Correct.
Another question, John.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
The trees you're talking about don't have enough space to plant all the trees. The implication you had was that we've got so many trees left over, we're gonna sprinkle them throughout the city. Do you have a sense of how many trees can't fit on here? And I assume that is because if you're taking down a 20-inch tree, or say, whatever, 10-inch tree, you're replacing that with 5 2-inch caliber trees. And I know in the past we've said, well, the math works.
Right.
Just the same as 2 5-inch trees, you know, and so if some of the concern over the picture you showed across the street of the mature trees in front is going to be contrasted by these tiny little trees, you know, in the development, and so if we can.
Yeah, it becomes really hard and really expensive with big trees, and I'm not, you know, and this isn't, we still have more trees in this property than an awful lot of area in the neighborhood, so it didn't seem like it was a good use of resources to do them. We still do larger trees than many developers. I mean, you know, our zoning standards are stricter in terms of the size of the trees. So I guess most of the answer is it didn't make a lot of sense from a resource standpoint. It was better to spread them out. I did do the number in the application. I don't remember offhand what it is.
So you're still gonna meet the caliber?
Yes.
Requirement. But it's not all gonna be done on these 10 lots.
I'm just wondering, and maybe it's not prudent, but if the ones that face Burt's Pit,
right,
that are directly opposite the mature trees across the street, if you're gonna make a good faith effort with setbacks and so forth to kind of replicate what's in the neighborhood, then instead of a 2-inch tree, maybe a 3-inch, just maybe,
right,
just those on the, just a little bigger.
The
right
question is, how big can you go without,
right,
the damage?
I get that a 5-inch tree costs an arm and a leg, and it doesn't make a lot of sense, but that's as many,
but if
you have to go to the minimal.
Right, if we restricted it to that particular view, then it seems like it would still leave plenty, you know, to do elsewhere.
Yeah, yeah, you know, I would prefer not, but if that's a condition, that's fine. We're still gonna live with that, so.
It looks like that would maybe be 10 or 11 trees that are on Burt's Pit.
So invest a little heavier in those.
Just,
and then,
I don't
yeah
know, just throwing it out there.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions or comments before the board, before we open it for public comment?
Just on the traffic mitigation, so the consensus is that the multi-use trail compensates for the dollar value of what the traffic mitigation would have been. That's what the...
Right, because it was only at 6,000,
yeah.
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 Valuing the conservation land about 400,000, the lots at 100,000. So we're spending $400,000 in the open space. I can't break it down to what's the value of the trail versus elsewhere.
Right, right.
From a, you know, when we've been buying trail from National Grid, for example, we're usually paying about $2 a square foot. So from a straight standpoint, what do we pay for that piece? This is far more valuable.
Yep. Okay.
All right. I think we'll open the hearing for public comment. Just a reminder, how this works is that if you are making public comment, you're speaking to us, not to the rest of the room. And if you have questions, wait, and we'll go in turn. And then if we can, we'll try and keep it open. So even when we have other questions, we can still have some interaction. But that just how it works. And Ms. LaBarge, if you'd like to start.
Councilor Marianne LaBarge, and thank you. I had sent you a letter on May 21st. And I almost couldn't be here tonight either because of another obligation, but I wanted to make sure I was here. I think you can see, we don't have many residents here tonight of being against this project. And I highly believe as a counselor to have meetings first and be able to listen what the concerns are of the taxpayers and the homeowners. And we did hear. And here we have our director of planning who goes back to the planning department and does some changes. And these changes made a lot of people happy, and I'm happy about it. I'm not happy about 82 homes that could be built in that area. It's absolutely beautiful. The conservation land is beautiful. Way back, I worked with Doug Cole and another resident in preserving an area of a pond. And Doug was very good about that. Then Doug had passed away, and now the family is working with the city to go ahead and let us acquire 115 acres of open space, and that's what we want. We don't want massive development. Also, as city councilors and me as a city councilor, we highly agree with mixed housing. We had one resident, which I think Wayne handled it very, very easy, by saying, when you say affordable housing, right away, low income, okay? Didn't want low income families. And Wayne really educated the people about how much you make a year to be considered for affordable housing. And that's very, very valuable. I also feel that it's great to have a little bit higher class of homes mixed in with affordable housing and a great diversity. I am supporting this 100%. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other public comment on this project? Oh, I thought that's why you guys were. Got my hopes up. Any other questions from the board? Since we don't have, I think we'll just leave public comment open in case anything comes up, we can still ask Wayne.
I think my only point was where the council person, she brought up about mixing up the affordable housing, and I'm just curious to see how does that work really if once it's on place, this, because probably they are concerned about maintenance, right? Wayne brought up, I just wonder, maybe just bring it up to discussion or to think about it, how you can keep that and also give the right to the low income to be there. So how you mitigate any issue that can come up.
It's gonna be a challenge on this site. It's certainly one reason I'm careful about what conditions come on the property. So when we have wonderful pieces of property, State Hospital, where Valley CDC and Community Builders Inc. are trying to do a project, it's big enough that they can find tax credits, they can attract a lot of different affordable housing developers. When you're trying to do first-time home buyers on a single-family home, it's really hard. We're writing this land down to zero. We're not trying to sell it somewhere in the dollar. It's still gonna be really hard to attract developers. We do at one of these projects every couple of years, and typically Habitat for Humanity is the only entity that responds, because everybody else sort of has to make the numbers add up. Habitat, because they deal with a lot of volunteer labor and a lot of donated materials, can make it work. And even Habitat is very nervous about, you see on this view, there's two homes along the road, which would be zero lot line, two homes we built against each other, yeah, and a short driveway. Mm-hmm. My guess is Habitat's gonna bid on this. They've expressed interest. Again, they want to have an inside track. We're gonna bid, but it's very likely they're gonna bid, and they do a lot of hand-holding even once things are built. The lot to the right, which will have a common driveway, which makes them more nervous in terms of ability to pay later, they may not be interested in. So when I was prefacing this, I said, we'd like to make them affordable to people earning 60 to 80% of their median income, but we might go as high as 100% of median income, and that's the reason. I suspect those two lots to the left probably Habitat will want, and they will usually aim at 60% for the first buyer, and then subsequent buyers at 80% of median income. But that one lot is probably going to be priced somewhat different to make up for those costs. And so So both mechanisms are going to be trying to build in maintenance and skiing. So Habitat helps their homeowners for a long time. The reason they like zero lot line homes instead of condos is it's really hard to make condex work. You know, so everyone owns their own home, even if it's a common wall. So we're well aware it's an issue. We're certainly part of what we're looking at is durable materials. And frankly, that's part of the reason for the green housing is if there's less money going out each month in your gas bill and your electric bill, then presumably that leaves more money to pay for redoing the roof when it's needed, for painting the house when it's needed.
Can you provide some examples of where this has already occurred that has worked?
Sure, I can tell you the ones that we've been involved with. Mm-hmm. So on Route 66 West Hampton Road, about a half mile east of Glendale Road, we did a similar project, a little smaller than this, and there's six Habitat for Humanity homes. It stands out because every other home in that area is single family, and then you have this cluster of three duplexes, but it's worked out well. This picture on the bottom right is on Ryan Road. It was an area we bought like 40 acres and carved off one duplex that's just south of Clark Street on Ryan Road. On Pine Brook Curve, we just funded it. We weren't involved in that land, but behind Big Y, there's a duplex that's there. 237 South Street was a property we took for back taxes, and we gave it to a now defunct group, Northampton Land Trust, now Valley CDC, and put a duplex there.
And these have worked out, okay.
They've all worked out well. I mean, I will say, as with other homes, some are well-maintained and not so well-maintained. Our other big one is we gave lots at the end of Garfield to Habitat, five lots and there are five units there.
Mm-hmm.
It was one market rate house, and the person who bought the market rate house thinks that Habitat or that Habitat tenants aren't maintaining as well as she'd like, and she decided to set, actually she's donating her lot to Habitat. It's different degrees. We have not had any major problem that I'm aware of in terms of substantive lack of maintenance, roofs that leak, those kinds of things. We've certainly had noise complaints, but we have noise complaints from non-Habitat people. We've certainly had trash, again, from I couldn't tell you statistically if it's more or not. I know that during the recession, this is nationwide, this isn't our Habitat, Habitat says they had less foreclosures than the market as a whole because they do more hand-holding through the process. I don't know for sure about Pioneer Valley, but as far as I know, that's probably a similar statistic. But, you know, they're lower-income individuals, and I'm sure the times when some crisis happens, they can't maintain their home.
Don't take me wrong. I think on both sides, it's not just the income and low-income, because, that's how I just want to understand if there is a way to. So there is no strategy in place or policy in place that can deal with the situation, as each case has a different.
Right. The reason we like Habitat is because they stick around for a long time. They don't just sell a house and then be gone so that they're still there for dealing. The other reason, so there's sort of two philosophical approaches to affordable housing. We've tried to do both. One is you want it in places where people can walk to things that happen, because lower-income individuals have a lower car ownership rate.
Accessibility.
And that's, you can obviously, 125 units under construction on Pleasant Street, that's part of that piece. But the other is we don't have neighborhoods which are the rich neighborhoods and the poor neighborhoods, and so we believe in the scattered site piece. So on Glendale Road, the other place we did this lots, we sort of like, okay, there's going to be four Habitat lots here. There'd be three Habitat or somebody else lots here. So we're spreading around town. So the extent there is a social burden, I'm not saying there necessarily is, but the extent it's a social burden, that's being spread around the entire city.
And
one
is handicap accessible.
Yes, right. So again, we don't have someone for this yet, but on Glendale Road, Habitat's doing one of the four units being handicap accessible. If they did this, that would be a good assumption, but we don't know.
Questions, comments from the board?
I'm going to go through the DPW
comments.
So there's a concern in that. I guess this relates to the comment I think that Wayne made about the engineer plans for the on the stormwater side, but from the engineering side, DPW asked that the applicant provide construction drawings stamped by a PE to DPW for review prior to each phase and development, so before issuance of a building permit before each phase, because these are probably going to be sold as you know, in different increments.
And just to clarify, when you, when this, in this particular instance, when you're saying phase, it's actually meaning each lot?
Well, it could be a couple lots, so if
Well, if a developer bought more than one.
Right,
okay.
Right.
All right, I see what you're saying, okay.
If I could address that, so that's more or less in the stormwater permit, slightly different language there, but.
So if we have to live with it there, then as a condition here.
And then there was a comment that there's only one construction entrance shown for lots 8, 9, and 10, but they want similar stabilization noted on the plans at the construction entrances for all the proposed driveways, and that those should remain in place until the final driveway is constructed. And that the sheet shall have a note that the trees be protected and shall show the limits of the protection at the drip line, not the trunk line as shown. And the tree protection can accommodate multiple trees, you know, clusters at a time if necessary. So it doesn't have to be individually wrapped.
Is that in reference to new trees or existing?
No, to protect the existing trees. The ones that are shown to be slated to be saved, that tree protection has to go to the drip line. And it could be, you know, it could encompass multiple trees under one. And in terms of, there's some details about water and sewer, water service valves and clean outs at the property line. They want notes about clean out for lots 9 and 10 and notes about the service valves. I don't know if you want to put the details in there, but that's going to be a requirement when anybody comes. So you could have a blanket condition that says the details on the plan sheets need to be updated before they, you know, sell the lots, to incorporate the comments from DPW about the water service valves. There's a note in here that DPW cannot guarantee water pressure during peak demands at elevations above 320. This is a common comment that they make in higher elevation. So there are a couple of places it says, based on the elevation shown near the proposed structures, booster pumps may be needed for any second floor development. So I don't think that needs to be a condition, but it's just a note to, you know, in the file essentially for the applicant. So they, this might be a duplicate, a construction entrance detail shall be provided, but I think that's the, so the detail for the same, stabilization. And a tree detail also in accordance with ANSI 300 part 5 shall be provided, which is the standard tree protection requirement in the ordinance actually. That's it from DPW.
Wayne, just a question about from other projects, because I'm sure you've run into this, the situation with the trees of trying to, I guess the one concern I would have is just that we're going to plant some trees, and the ones we can't plant, we're going to put them somewhere else. Can we be more definitive? I don't know. I feel like I want a little more than kind of, and I don't know if you can. You may not be able to, but, you know, is there any way to say, well, we're going to put them in these three places, or I don't know, just something a little more definitive, at least for me. And I agree with, I think Mark, I still want to talk about Mark's concern about the size, but I don't know, that just seems a little a more undefined, I guess.
So two ways to approach it. I can tell you right now where we're planning to put them if you want that, or you can just ask as a condition that we give you an accounting.
Okay.
So we're happy to keep track of them all.
Okay.
The only, I mean, we could mostly give it to you now, the only unknown is we'd like to plant some on Elwha Island. You know,
Where is that?
So if you go across the bike path bridge, across the Connecticut River, it's the island, the bike path bridge is one piece. And you see that half the island is not wooded.
Right.
It hasn't been farmed in 60 years, it just hasn't come back.
Got it.
But the problem is really hard and really expensive to get to the island. So that's my only hesitation. I can tell you if you go to Connecticut River Greenway, we're doing trees there. Chesterfield Road, we're doing trees there. So I can tell you all the areas. The Elwell is my only unknown.
Is there any chance to do the more of the elms?
Don't know the answer in terms of cost, and I think partially depends on nature. We've had discussions with Nature Conservancy in the past. One possibility is that they provide the labor and we provide the tree, or vice versa. So if we could leverage that, yes, if they're a lot more expensive, probably. Yeah, yeah. It's also still pretty experimental which elms are going to survive.
Yeah.
And which
right,
ones.
Yeah. So they just did
how long
one down.
Ago was that done?
6 years ago. And their problem, frankly, is not the elm trees, it's the vine, the horrible vine we have.
Sweet.
Sweet, yeah.
Yes.
Bittersweet.
Bittersweet.
Yeah.
Their problem is they feel like they have to go out there twice a year because the bittersweets are really trying to race up and kill the trees. Now, obviously, you know, the elms we have in front of First Churches seem to be doing well.
Yeah.
But that's my only hesitation. You know, certainly if you wanted to do a few, I'm happy to. I'd hate to put all our eggs in that one.
Yeah. Well, I wonder, I don't know, and I don't know, this just me, I don't know what the rest of the board think, but maybe it's a, whenever they're all done, some kind of accounting, like, hey,
right.
This is where all those trees went, or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, we'll be obligated under zoning to monitor once a year, so we can both give you a spreadsheet where we planted them and the report for however many years the zoning makes us look at. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions, comments from the board?
I think we should request the slightly, you know, larger trees, maybe not to the 5-inch level,
right.
But I don't know what that, I think it would be appropriate to do that.
Can I get a sense, Wayne, on that, I don't want to say if there's 10 or 12 trees and we want to make those a little bigger on Burt's Pit, and there are, I'm making this up, if there's only 10 extra trees and we're asking for, by the increase in the size of those on Burt's Pit Road, we're asking, in effect, 30 extra trees, you know, if the numbers are imbalanced, can we find out how many extra trees we have so that we can? Well, if we're going to leverage those extra trees,
right.
Bigger trees on Burt's Pit, I want to be fair. And what do people think about that? Is that
I like it just because it puts the resources where they're coming from, in a sense, where
right.
They're coming from as much. And I think we try and do that as much as possible. I mean, I'm sure the people that are going to be moving there will be thrilled to hear that we planted trees somewhere else. But,
right.
You know, I'm sure they're good citizens. And but they probably like some trees there as well. So
then the question is, what's the balance?
Right.
The sustainability of a larger one and moving it in.
Right.
And Mark, you said you thought you counted that maybe there would be 11?
Well, I mean, if you're just looking at the ones on Burt's Pit,
right.
That fate is going right to left, 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9. I mean, it could be 9 to 11, depending on the ones that are right on the,
right.
There's no sidewalk, but the ones that are right on the road would be 9. And I'm just saying, if it seems like almost every effort was made with setbacks and so forth and meeting with the people in the neighborhood, and this would just go a little, because the diagrammatically, the size of the trees shown are, that's a tree in 25 years, you know.
Right.
It's not what's being planted.
Right. Yeah, but if Ford's comfortable with 3 inches and then just whatever the math comes out to be in terms of that extra caliper, that number of trees would reduce, so that's fine.
Yeah,
and is it safe to assume that there's
more than enough?
Yeah, there's the excess of trees is will compensate for the three. Oh yeah.
More than.
Okay. Okay. Do I hear a motion to close public hearing?
Motion to close public hearing.
Tess and Ann. All in favor?
Yep.
A conversation or a motion? Whichever. We've already had a lot of conversation.
So, question on the setback, what they're proposing, do we have to make that a condition, or is it because it's a range starting at 41 feet?
Well, it's shown on the plans where they are. So you might want to confirm that in the decision, because this will be bid out, and different people may bid on each one. So if you're bidding on lot, you know, 2 or whatever, it should be clear that those are the setbacks, because when when an applicant comes into the building department and says, I'm in the water supply protection district, or the SR district, and they show they're meeting the setbacks, then it's gonna look like they're meeting the setbacks.
Right.
And it's much, I mean, these are much more significant setbacks than what the zoning allows. So, I would say that you would, reference the, plans to say the setback shall be as shown on the plans.
But the footprint doesn't have to look the same?
No, not the footprint, just the the site.
Just the location of the front, right.
So this is not a site plan?
Technically, as it's a special permit with site plan, so you're approving the site plan, so.
So that means this is the way it's gonna be positioned?
Right, but just to confirm, you know, take it to that next level and say, you know, this, the setbacks are shown, even though the concept structure, it's a concept structure, and you're not approving the structure itself.
Right.
You wanna approve the location of those structures and make sure that that's clear. So if it's in the decision, it's much easier when there's a review down at the building department when an application comes in, that there's a condition there that says the setbacks for these lots are as shown on the plan.
Mm-hmm.
So they only vary in that, you know, they're not exactly uniform across, so.
Right.
So we can say instead of at a minimum of 41-foot setback, we can say as shown on the plans.
Yeah.
Because the plans show everything from, you know, 53, 67,
right, it should
42.
Be varied.
Mm-hmm. Right, I mean, you could say minimally 41 and as shown on the plans.
Okay.
And so when somebody, if a developer comes, you know, and has one or two of these lots, we aren't going to see a site plan again for when someone, so this is it, so,
yep.
Okay.
And you're approving it, so so just to make sure you all understand, the site, I mean, this is a very detailed site plan. It shows where the rain gardens are going, where the tree planting's going, you know, where the driveways are going. So that's all part of the approval.
There was a question too, John, in the staff comments about
yeah.
maintenance and easement agreements for shared driveways. Does that need to be a condition?
Yes, because that's typically required upon submittal, but again, these are not, we don't know who the end users are, and that's usually established once you're, you know, building the parcels out.
Can I ask a question about that? So, these are not condos, but they're,
right.
but they're gonna have a shared...
They'll have easements.
They'll have easements, so each is granting the easement to the other, in a sense.
Right, so there'll be an easement for access to, you know, however lot, so if there are three on a shared driveway, right, then it'll just be for those three lots, it'll be just an easement for access and a maintenance agreement so that everyone's responsible for the maintenance of the driveway.
Okay, any other conversation or discussion before I'm glad to entertain a motion, which might have a lot of conditions on it.
Well, that's what I was going to say.
Mark's been taking good notes.
I was just going to say, if these conditions are it, so the proposed setback as shown, one, the tree caliper 3-inch
yeah.
on Burt's Pit is 2, DPW comments,
three.
I don't know if we can lump that together, and the maintenance and easement agreements,
four.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's what I've got.
So it'll
and we can leave the DPW just kind of as stated?
Well, I'd like to run through them and just sort of propose some language that so that it's specific that, you know, prior to construction, the plans are amended to show the driveway construction details and for all the driveways, not just the one. And the tree protection
mm-hmm.
measures in accordance with the ANSI 300, and that prior to each phase, there's a stamped construction drawings by a PE or submitted
yeah.
for DPW review. And
something
that
about service valves.
That was for the driveway.
Oh, okay. All
right. And that the water and service valves shall be installed in accordance with DPW requirements. And I think that just gets it a little bit more specificity.
Okay. and the, where the trees will end up being planted, is, but that's already kind of sort of shown, or can we make that?
So you can say that, so you can just say that the tree replacement shall be done in accordance with the zoning, and shall be documented as specified in the zoning. And I don't know if you want, that would be, you know, that's, we anyway, closed public comment, so I'm just sort of thinking through this. The number of trees, so, I guess that will have to be as part of the
condition.
Lot sale, prior to the sale of each lot, that documentation has to be, because the trees aren't gonna come down all at once, they're gonna come down in phases.
Right.
So, but the city is going to take the responsibility for planting those trees?
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Offsite.
The offsite trees, right. So, I think that could be done prior to the lot sales, is sort of the documentation of where the offsite trees will be planted.
And just to point out that the calipers are already at 3 to 3.5 proposed.
Oh.
I think what Wayne was saying is they could be 2, but they already are
I
3 to 3.5.
3.5, 3, 3.
Well, the ones along the street are all 3.
The ones along the street are all 3.
So
some of the others in the back are 2.
So you might then just confirm that, as shown on the plans, the trees along Burt's Pitch Hill.
At a minimum.
Minimally.
Feet.
Yeah.
What about traffic mitigation? That's in your.
So you'll.
Oh, we need
it's
to.
In the application,
yeah.
No, you're accepting that. They've shown how
okay, we're accepting that. Okay.
Yeah.
So back to the trees. Are we saying so? It shows 3, 2.5 to 3. So are we saying
it shows
3.5
in some places?
It shows 3 to 3.5 on the street.
Yeah.
So
we want to say 3.5 everywhere.
I can read it.
I think it's probably going to be site specific. I think
yeah.
If your issue is that you want them bigger on the front, that makes sense,
right.
And it's at and it's shown on the plan. But it also gives flexibility for other spots on the parcel if they can't find those that size exactly that.
And there's only 3 that are 2.5.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot more.
There's 2 of them on the far left side.
Right. The first 3 going left to right are 2.5.
They can't go below that. That's the minimum in zoning.
So we're just saying.
So we could say essentially we're going to raise the minimum to 3.5.
That's what I'm asking. What is.
You're saying, what you would say is that as shown on the plans, the trees along Burt's Pit Road shall be planted at a minimum of 3-inch, shall be 3-inch caliper at a minimum upon planting.
Okay. What's the difference in cost between a, I've never bought a tree outside of buying a tree from Costco, so what is the difference in 2, 2.5, 3, and 3.5 inch? I mean, to me.
What do you mean in cost? What's the cost
difference?
Yeah.
It depends on the species.
Yeah. I mean, I do think that that's. I mean, allowing we don't want to put a huge burden on. Huge burden on the development of this project.
No, but if you're taking down a.
Right.
That much larger, right?
12, 15 inch tree, and you're replacing it with a 2.5
yeah.
right.
inch tree. That's going to take 40 years to get. Back to where that original tree. We're talking a half. I don't think. You know the difference between a 2.5 and a 6-inch tree is exponential.
Okay.
The difference between a 2.5 and a 3 is.
I mean that's.
Yeah.
I have
yeah.
no idea.
Yeah. yeah.
And we're only talking about in
just
along
a few trees.
Yeah.
Along the street. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So the trees along Burt's Pit shall be at a minimum of 3.
Right.
And shown on the plan.
And shown. All right, want me to take a shot at this?
I'm sure your notes are better than mine.
Motion to approve the special permit for 10-lot open space residential cluster development and site plan for shared driveways with associated site development by Office of Planning and Sustainability on Burt's Pit Road, Florence, map ID 29-012/10, with the following conditions. Proposed setback at a minimum of 41 feet, and as per the drawings, the tree caliper, a minimum of 3-inch along Burt's Pit Road, as shown on the drawings. Maintenance and easement agreements to be established. DPW comments as follows: construction documents signed by, stamped by a PE before each phase, stabilization at construction entrances for all developments, protection of existing trees, or Nancy 3-something. Cleanouts and service valve details to be included on the drawings per the DPW comments, and documentation of the planting of the extra trees prior to the sale of each lot.
Second.
Second by Tess. Any discussion? All in favor?
All opposed?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to do the A&R one still here?
Oh, sure. So as part of this, because of the, I mean, this happens occasionally, but usually doesn't happen until the lots sell or about to sell, is I have an A&R plan that's only approvable as approval not requiring a subdivision once you approve a special permit for the layout, because this required, and I described this, I think, the last time when you approved the two A&Rs for the other pieces. So this is the A&R for the division of those lots into 10 lots. So I just need a vote for you to allow me to endorse the plans, because you've just approved the special permit and site plan for this.
Motion. All in favor?
Yep.
Just as a question, should that have gone like the opposite way? I mean, should we have done that?
No, you can't, because it wouldn't be,
it
wouldn't meet the frontage requirement until you approve the special permit, which is why you had to have the vote first, yeah, right.
Okay.
No, because we have another permit.
I'll now call for the 7:00 item, special permit for more than one curb cut site plan, reduction of required parking at Atwood Drive LLC, major project to construct a 3-story, 66,000 square foot four-story, 77,000 square foot office building, with associate site work at 23 Atwood Drive, Northampton, map ID 391443.
John, I have to make my, is the presentation by Time Bond?
Yes.
Okay, so due to the nature of my work, I have occasion to work with some of the presenters in this case. We're currently working with Time Bond. I don't think it proves me from being objective, and if anybody thinks that, I can recuse myself if you raise your hand.
Would anyone like Mark to be recused?
We're all comfortable with that.
All right.
I'm an engineer with Ty and Bond. I'm here tonight with Grace, who is our staff engineer. We're here tonight to present the application for site plan review for a major project at the Hospitality North project. This project has some history. We've been before the board before. Just to briefly summarize, this redevelopment has been in the works, or at least in the brains of the owners and the property developers, since the late 1990s. There's been some zoning changes to encourage development here. It's located on Atwood Drive, the north side of Atwood Drive. The south side of Atwood Drive, it was the Northwood development. I think that was around 2011, 2012. And then in 2013, we were here to present a similar project, which included some general medical office space, a hotel, and a restaurant. And then we did receive site plan review and special permit in November 2013 for that. Today, it formerly was the Clarion Hotel and Conference Center that has been demolished as of last year. It's a 7.8 acre parcel, zoned general business with a floodplain protection district overlay. And for resource areas on site, we have a wetland off of our property to the north and then along our property to the west. This project is pretty much all in bordering and subject to flooding as well, which is conservation's. So again, here's the existing condition plan if you refer back to later. Our proposed development at this point, or our proposed development, I should say, includes two office buildings. We've removed the hotel component and the restaurant component and replaced it